the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to where my has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
All right. Good morning. Good morning. Sorry, we're a little bit after 8 o'clock. We had some technical difficulties this morning, so no worries. We want to welcome you here this morning. Last night, I said good morning, so it's just a habit. I can't even break it. So, but today, it's right, so we're doing good. So it's so good to see all of you, at least half your faces again, and those that are worshiping with us online today. We just want to welcome you to the service this morning. If you're a guest with us, whether that's here in person or online, I'm going to ask you to pull out your phone and text WELCOME to 720-575-5713, and that's just a way that we'll be able to connect with you this week and reach out to you, see if there's a way we can be a blessing to you, and we just all honestly just want to get to know you a little bit. I also have a really unique thing. So we're in a weird time. We're so used to, I can't imagine a time ever that we couldn't pass out a bulletin, and so it's even weird. I feel like I'm always missing something as I sit down, and I know how much you guys like that. So Pastor Mark put together a way for us to have a virtual bulletin. So, now, the only person that I know for sure that can't participate is Wayne, because he still has a flip phone, so I don't think it works. Sorry. But if you have a phone, and it's semi-new-ish, and you pull out your camera, so you can see I'm taking a picture, and I show my camera at the screen there, it's going to pick up that code, and it's going to bring me to a web page. Okay? And then that page is the sermon notes for this morning, and it's got all of our announcements and a link to giving. So it's got all of that on there for you. So it's kind of our little virtual bulletin. So we'll be doing that for you throughout the upcoming weeks, and that's just a way that we can kind of get that information to you. So it's got the Bible right there. So if, as Pastor Bryce teaches this morning, you can click on that and add notes and do some fun stuff. So just have fun playing with that as Pastor Bryce is preaching this morning. So in just a second, we're going to worship together, but let's pray and ask God to bless the service. Dearly Father, we just thank you for the ability to gather this morning, both in person and online. What a privilege it is just to come together as the body of believers and worship and honor you. God, we just ask that as we start the service today, Lord, that we would all be able to just pause for a moment and clear our minds and our heads of any distractions, of any worries, of anything that's going on in life, and focus solely on you this day. And that as we worship you this morning, as we open your word later and Pastor Bryce preaches, Lord, we just ask that you are the sole focus, and we just glean the truth that you offer us today, Lord. We just also ask that in this time of uncertainty that you would be our rock, and that we would be able to rely on you and that trust in you, and we just need your help to do that. God, we just ask that this whole COVID thing is ended in a supernatural way by your hand, and that only you could get that credit, Lord. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One more thing this morning. So, we got to, a couple weeks ago, celebrate all the big accomplishments of our Awana program. Those kids put in a lot of work this year, and their year was modified a bit, to just put it lightly. But even with the not being able to meet in person, they all put in effort to finish their books and earn rewards, and we got to celebrate that a few weeks ago. And we want to celebrate with them today and let you all know that there was two big milestone awards that which these kids have to put in a lot of work. It's years and years of accomplishing work to accumulate these awards. So we want to play a short video and share those with you today.
Hello, MABC Church family. This is David Pershing, and I'm here as, on behalf of Awana as the Awana Commander, and I have a couple of milestone awards I would like to present. The first one is the Meritorious Award that we have, and we have one person that qualified for that this year. Qualifying for a Meritorious Award means completing six books, which is approximately 6 years' worth of work. Multiple verses are having to be learned, probably in the neighborhood of 250 to 300 verses, not the easy kind like John 3:16. There's a lot more difficult verses, extended passages. And then as you get into some of the more advanced books, there's a lot more Bible study and stuff going on. So they have to read a book of the Bible. Perhaps it might be Ruth, it might be 1 John, might be Romans. And then after reading through it, they'll answer questions. They have to outline the book, different things like that. So it starts to teach them Bible study habits, not just memorization. So with that, Riker Phelps, who also helps in our Awana program, has earned his Meritorious Award. Congratulations, Riker. And then we have our second milestone award that we're going to be doing. This is the Timothy Award. The Timothy Award is awarded to people who have actually finished four books worth of material. Again, more memory work in this level of book work. They have about 250 to 300 verses, and those same verses are not the John 3:16 verses or whatever. There's a lot of more difficult verses, extended passages that they're doing, memorizing the books of the Bible, doing missionary type study where they learn about a missionary and do mission type activity, and just different things like that, that they learn about. And they're learning about different questions that they might encounter in their lifetime, as far as who is God, who is Jesus, what does the Bible say, how do we know the Bible is true, those kinds of things. And not only are they learning the answers, they're learning the verses, which is where their memory work comes from, learning the verses that support that those questions, so that when they encounter those questions in their life, in their school, with their friends, they have a biblical viewpoint on how to answer that. So the person who won that award this year at MABC is Emma King, and she gets her Timothy Award. Come on up, Emma. Good job for you. Thank you very much for that, and appreciate the opportunity to serve you here in the Awana program. And congratulations to both Riker and Emma, who accomplished these milestones this year.
Well, the Lord gave us a beautiful morning today. Let's stand and sing and praise Him today.
We praise Thee, O God, for the Son of Thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah. revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for the Spirit of life, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the Lamb who was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us with the Lord in the light of His Word. What a glory He sheds on our way. Let us do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey.
Let's sing it, trust.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross. Just if we trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no but to trust and obey.
The next song is He Lives. Let's sing it like He lives this morning.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer, and just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to
be seated.
Well, good morning, church family. It's great to be with you this morning. You all look like you're smiling behind your mask today, so that's good. That's what we want to see, right? So I told the group last night, I said, it's great to see you all, and they were as dead as cucumbers. And I said, no, wait a minute. It's 5 o'clock on a Saturday evening. You guys should have some energy unless you burn it out all day today. So hopefully we'll have a little more energy this morning at 8 o'clock, right? So it's good to be with you. Thank you for Charles and April for leading us this morning, Michelle. And so we are excited to be here. I told the group last night that every time I see you, it just reminds me of how much I missed you during those 3 months or so that we weren't able to gather together. And so it's a good reminder to see you guys in person and to be back gathered together as the church. And so we are excited to be here this morning. If you have your Bibles, if you would turn with me to Ecclesiastes, into the 12th chapter, Ecclesiastes 12. And I know some of y'all are thinking, what in the world are we doing going into Ecclesiastes, right? Well, Pastor Mark is on vacation for the week, well-deserved, and he is in Ohio with family. And so he asked if I would... So this, honestly, this passage, we... in our small group, the Ignite group, Pastor Bobby and I lead for kind of the younger adults, we had gone through Ecclesiastes in the last, you know, few months, and we got to the 12th chapter, and I taught that chapter, and these verses just stuck with me, and I just can't get rid of them, to be quite honest. And so when Mark asked if I would preach this weekend, I knew that the Lord was leading me to this passage. And so we're going to be in the 12th chapter of Ecclesiastes here in just a moment. But I first want to just hope and wish you all had a happy 4th last weekend. We were in Alabama seeing family, which is always a joy and a pleasure. We don't get to see my folks much, and so we were there. You know, we get there about once every year, year and a half. And so I was in Alabama in the hot humidity, and we looked at each other, April and I, and said, we don't miss this too much, right? So we're out watching fireworks at night, and we are sweating, and we're not doing anything. We're just standing still, and we're sweating, and so we realized very quickly that God bless Colorado, right? And so we're very grateful to be here. But it was great to see family, to see parents, to see my brother and his family, and I even got to reconnect with some of my mentors from my childhood, from my kind of growing up years. One of them is Mr. Casey, who's a deacon at my church at First Baptist Jacksonville, businessman. He's now retired, but he, for some reason, saw something in a knucklehead teenager that I was and just invested in me, spent time and poured his life into me. It was great to reconnect. I got to reconnect with one of my high school teachers I was closer in high school to my ag teacher than anybody else. All the educators out there will squirm when I tell this story, but my senior year, we didn't have the option to graduate early. I had all the credits that I needed except for two. I had to have an English and a science, so I had 12th grade English and I had physics, and then those were my first two classes of the day, and then the next four periods I was in the ag building. And so I pretty much just hung out there the rest of the day. And so I got to hang out with Mr. Whaley. My boys don't really like him. They don't know him, but they don't like him because all the sayings that I tell them came from him. He's just a good old boy, right? So, you know, whenever I ever tell you, hey, I can lead a horse to water, but I can't make him drink it, right? That's a Ricky Whaley saying that he just bore in my head over years. But it was great to reconnect with him. But in that moment, as I'm, you know, in Alabama and I'm reconnecting with these folks, and I had the privilege of, I grew up in the same town. I went to school from kindergarten through 12th grade with the same school. We don't have a middle school. We went to Kittystone Elementary School, kindergarten through 6th. 7th grade, went to high school, and there were about 50 of us in my class that all grew up and started kindergarten together and finished high school together. And so when I go home, that's the only hometown I've known, right? And so all these memories begin to flood back, the good, the bad, the ugly, as I call it, right? So you drive by houses where your friends used to live, and you remember, you know, hanging out with them. And then you drive by, I had a lawn business when I was a kid, so I would drive by and just look at all the lawns that I used to mow. And I just had all these memories just begin to flood, you know, my mind. And I just had this realization kind of where I've come in life, where I started as a young man, and I've now grown into being this adult man, right? And it's just that moment and that opportunity to reflect. And I'm going to say this, and please, I mean this with all humbleness, right? So I think I have reached the point where I can consider myself a mature adult man, right? Now, I'm going to talk to men for just a second here. You know, we have a lot of grown males in our society that are not men, right? But I think in my life, I mean, when we have 30% fatherless home in America, we have a problem. We have an issue. So we have a lot of males who are not men but have grown up and now they're older, but they're still not really men. They're boys in an adult male's body, right? And I think I have transcended by the grace of God and I've become a man, right? And so as I begin to just ponder that, you know, when you have that kind of nostalgic moment. Now, talking last night to the younger crowd, they don't get it yet, right? I mean, they're still in their 20s. I remember when I was in my 20s, like, I didn't look back at anything in my life. I was like, what are you talking about? Nostalgia. Oh, come on, right? Well, now that I'm almost 40 and I have kids of my own and I realize that I'm no longer the kid, I'm now the adult going back to where I grew up, it changes things. And I begin to ponder, what was it in my life that took me from being this young knucklehead boy to this grown knucklehead man, right? That's what my wife would say. I'm still a knucklehead, right? And so what is it in my life that took me from point A all the way to point B? And that's when I begin to really appreciate those relationships with my father and with my mother and with my local church and the men in my life, my older brother Nolan, my John Holloway, Rick Casey, Rick Whaley, all these men in my life that invested in me, that used scripture to teach me and guide me. And by the grace of God, he has moved me from being here to now being the grown man. Well, this morning, I want us to look at that together from kind of the spiritual sense. How do we go from being new babes in Christ, what Paul would describe as drinking milk? How do we grow from that into being spiritually mature adults that are eating meat? How do we do that? And I'm talking to a crowd here this morning, and I said this last night, and I'm going to say it again. There's more target people in here, but I grew up in a church, a small, fundamental, independent church, right? We didn't have very many people show up on Sunday morning. This crowd would have been huge for us. We were very small. But I saw people in my life, and this is one of the sad stories of my life. I saw people in my life who came to church every Sunday, who came every Wednesday night, came every Sunday night, who just did all the things you had to do, but were still either immature believers or not believers at all because they had not grown spiritually. I said this last night, and I'll kind of say it again with a little clause, right? We worry about how many times you come here to gather corporately with the church. We do care about that. We are far more concerned with how much time you spend in God's Word at home alone than how much time you spend here. Yes, Pastor Mark weekly preaches the Word of God. Yes, in your small groups that hopefully you're attending. Right now it's difficult on Zoom or whatever. Hopefully you're getting the Word of God there. But that should just be the bare minimum. That should be the beginning. That should be the appetizer, because you should be going home and studying the Word of God yourself so that you can dive into it and it can begin to change you. And so how do we go from being young in Christ to being a mature believer? And I think that's what Solomon's writing about in Ecclesiastes. You see, just a little context about Ecclesiastes. If you've not read the book recently, it's a book of wisdom written by King Solomon. It's written by, this is very important, it's written by an older King Solomon, right? He is near the end of his reign. And we all know that with age hopefully comes wisdom, right? And so I love the book, and oftentimes it's misunderstood, but if you go back in the first chapter, in the second verse, he kind of outlines this theme for the rest of the book, right? He says, vanity is vanity, all is vanity. And he begins to list all these things that are vanity. But what you have to understand, he's talking about all of life is vanity without God, right? All of life is vanity without God. And so as he begins to then write the book, we often know a lot of passages out of Ecclesiastes, right? There's actually even a famous movie that was written based off Ecclesiastes. Remember the movie Footloose, right? Remember the old movie Footloose? And they quote Ecclesiastes 3, right? There's a time to dance, and they're trying to make their argument for why they should have their high school dance. You see, Solomon kind of works through the vanity of life, because you see, if you don't know much about Solomon, here's a little bit of tidbit. God said, I'll give you anything that you ask for, and he asked for wisdom. And so God granted him wisdom, and so Solomon was the wisest man in the world. But with his wisdom, he also had great wealth, he had great power, he had way too many wives, he had 700 wives, which was obviously showing proof that he had strayed from God. He had forgotten Genesis 1 and 2, quite obviously, right? He had all the choice foods and wines he wanted. And in the book, he says that he had chased all those things, and nothing brought him satisfaction. Nothing brought him contentment. Nothing brought him fulfillment. And so then in the 12th chapter, in the 8th verse, if you look just one verse prior to what we're going to read today, he ends the book by saying the same thing. He says, look, vanity of vanity, says the preacher, all is vanity. He starts the book with that saying. He ends the book. But then he comes to our passage this morning, and he adds this on, which I think is very important. So if you have your Bibles, if you would open and look with me at the 12th chapter of Ecclesiastes in verse 9. These are the words of Solomon, continuing on down to the end of the book through verse 14. Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. The words of the wise are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd. My son, beware of anything beyond these. Of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or whether evil. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning for the opportunity to come together as the body of Christ this morning to worship you and to study your word. I just pray for the next few moments that we're together that you would just speak through me. May my words be your words. May my thoughts be your thoughts, Lord. And may we all leave here changed because we've encountered the righteous, holy, living God. And so, Father, I just pray this morning that we would just put aside all the things, that the distractions and the hindrances in our life. May we lay those aside for the next few moments and just focus solely on you. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we read the text, I think there's a main idea this morning that I just want to point out from the very beginning. And we're going to kind of work to that with just kind of the ways we walk through the text. And the main idea is just simply this. If we were looking to be spiritually mature, If we are looking to move from being an infant in Christ to being an adult in Christ, our life must be focused on learning and following God's word, because that leads to maturity in Christ. Again, a life focused on learning and following God's word is one that leads to maturity in Christ. Look, here's the example and what we understand in this, right? One of our core values at Mississippi Avenue Baptist Church is this: who grows disciples? God does, right? What's the basis for that? 1 Corinthians 3:6, and Paul's writing to the church in Corinth. And he says this, he says, look, Apollos planted, I watered, but God gives the growth, right? So we understand, even in my life, and I look back at these men and women in my life who have helped me grow from point A to point B, I understand that it was God at work in that, right? And so we need to understand that there's a difference in knowledge and following. Right, we were talking last night after the service with Mandy, and she was talking about 700 wives for Solomon, and he's the wisest man in the world. I said, yes, there's a difference in wisdom and then applying that wisdom, right? Well, you can know what the right thing to do is. You can know what the choice to do is. You can learn God's word, but then you have to take the second step and follow God's word. Solomon is a prime example, even as the author of the text this morning, that he did not do both well at times. Right? And I think that's why he's sitting back in an old age as his rule is coming to an end. He's writing this book. He's referencing himself here as the preacher, by the way, because he's preached these sermons to the people of Israel. And as he's doing this, I think he's recognizing the error of his ways and how he has not always learned and followed God's word. And folks, we're not perfect. None of us are perfect. And we're not saying that we are perfect. But what we do know is that it's a twofold enterprise. We're learning and we're following. And so the first thing we see right off the bat, I think for mature believers, there's three things I want us to see about mature believers. So if your goal, if you're not sure where you are today, if you're an immature believer or a mature believer and you're trying to figure that out, there's three things the text tells us that mature believers do. And the first is just simply, mature believers study and teach Scripture. Look at what Solomon says here. The preacher, besides being wise, in verse 9, also taught the people knowledge. He taught the people. Now you're sitting there saying probably, well, Pastor Bryce, I'm not a preacher. I'm not a small group leader. I don't have the gift of teaching. And I would say that's totally fine. You are not required to have the gift of teaching or preaching to teach other people. Are you a parent? Are you a grandparent? Do you have nieces and nephews? Do you have aunts and uncles? Do you have coworkers or neighbors? In other words, do you interact with anybody else in your life? Right? Because I know that we all have those moments where people come up and begin to ask us questions about life. They begin to ask us certain things. And so there is the opportunity that God is giving you to begin to teach Scripture through your response. I'm seeing this very clearly and easily with my 8-year-old, right? So you know my boys. I have an 8-year-old who is as tenderhearted as they come. I have a 5-year-old who is as spirited as they come, right? And so what bothers the 5-year-old does not bother the 8-year-old. That's just the way it goes. But my 8-year-old in recent, months has come home a couple of times and just been very upset about something because someone has hurt his feelings or has said something to him or something of that nature. Well, that is God giving me the prime opportunity to open God's word and teach my child about what the gospel of Jesus Christ says. When your neighbor comes to you and begins to ask you life questions, and the culture that we're living in with all the uncertainty and the uprise, there are opportunities more and more and more to have those conversations. Mature believers teach God's word, just as Solomon exampled and just as he talked about. He taught the people knowledge. But the second part of that is that in order to teach something, you have to know something, right? Now, I know there are some times people teach and they don't know what they're doing. Like, I get that. We're not talking about YouTube here, right? So we're not talking about those situations. We're talking about handling God's word, right? So in order for you to teach the word of God, you must know the word of God. And what did Solomon do here? Here's three easy points to think about as we talk about teaching and studying Scripture. He says this: he weighed, he studied, and he arranged. He weighed, he studied, and he arranged. So what does that mean? Well, to weigh is to ponder or to think about things. Now, one thing in our culture that we do very poorly is just to slow down and smell the roses. COVID-19 has done one thing for us that I hope has a lasting effect, and that has shown us that we don't have to go a million miles an hour all the time. We can sit and ponder and think about the blessings of the Lord. We don't have to worry about going from meeting to meeting to meeting or going to work and this and this. There are times in which I think our culture has become so fast-paced that we've lost the necessity, really, of just sitting back and reflecting on the Word of God. And that's exactly what Solomon would do. He would weigh the Scriptures. He would weigh the Proverbs. He would think about the Proverbs. Then he would study the Proverbs as well. You see there that he says that he would arrange. And then he would study, and he would weigh. He would actually be in the Word. He would read the Word. He would memorize the Word. He would know what the Word of God says. In order to repeat something, you must first know it. And then I love what he talks about arranging there. Many of you are small group leaders, and so you understand this. As you prepare a lesson, or as Pastor Mark weekly prepares to preach, he takes time to arrange the Scriptures in order to make sense. You don't just take the information, run out the door, begin to preach, right? You think about it, you study it, and then you figure out what is the best way for me to do this. Mature believers understand that. And mature believers understand that sometimes when someone comes to you with a question, the arrangement is just as important as the studying and the weighing, because how you teach somebody the truth can be just as important as teaching them the truth. What I mean by that is sometimes we're not called to just hit them with the head with a 2x4. Sometimes we have to listen and arrange what we are going to say and the truth that we are going to say by what the Holy Spirit is telling us and what might help them the most in their situation. I tend to be pretty direct at times. My wife reminds me of that, right? So there are oftentimes I just want to smack my kids with the spiritual 2x4, bam, right in the head. Well, that works with my youngest, it doesn't work with my oldest, right? So I have to learn how to arrange God's word as I teach him so that it can have the maximum effect. But mature believers understand that. They study and they teach the Scripture. Look at verse 10. He says, the preacher sought to find words of delight. He sought the Scriptures. He searched the Word to have words of delight. That's what Scripture is. Scripture is refreshing to us, right? It brings us joy. It brings us comfort. It brings us peace. And then uprightly, he did what? He wrote words of truth. This is the beginning of a very important doctrine of the church, and today we need to understand this. Solomon wrote words of truth. In verse 11, the words of the wise, speaking of himself, the words of the wise and the other biblical authors, they're like goads and like nails firmly fixed to the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd. So at the end of verse 10 and the beginning of verse 11, there's an important doctrine here called the doctrine of inspiration. You may say, well, Pastor Bryce, what does that mean? Well, here's what I'm talking about. We understand that the Word of God was written by mortal men like you and me, right? Now, we're not writing Scripture. Scripture is closed. That's done. But Solomon, David, Moses, Paul, Matthew, Mark, Luke, right? All those guys that wrote Scripture, it was not just simply them writing their own thoughts. What does it say very clearly here at the end of verse 11? All those wise sayings were given by what? One shepherd. And notice in your Scripture that shepherd is capitalized. That's because in the Hebrew, Solomon is referencing that this is given by God. And so in other words, what I'm also, the second point we need to see this morning is that spiritual believers, spiritually mature people, understand the authority of Scripture. We understand the authority of God's Word. Because this is not just some book that was randomly put together by different men throughout the history of our world. This is a book that was inspired by God, that the words were written by mortal men under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit has then protected and kept so that we may have it today in 2020. The authority of God's Word extends far beyond anything else. It is the only thing in our lives that does not change. I used this reference last night, and I'll say it again. Culture changes, right? Being back in Alabama, I'm reminded of the state that I love, but the air of its ways. The 1950s and 60s, it was a horrible place. The culture accepted racism. The culture promoted racism. That is directly contradictory to the authority of Scripture and God's Word. Culture today, the culture promotes abortion. Everyone has the right to do what they want with their bodies. The authority of Scripture says differently. Scripture says that all life has value from beginning to end, right? And that all life is valuable. All life is created in the image of God. And so the culture tells us differently, but the Word of God says different because it is the authority in our lives. I used this last night and I'll say it again. Folks, if you want to change your life, I'm going to get in trouble for this one. But if you want to change your life, the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning and your feet hit the floor, go get your coffee or Diet Coke in my case, right? I got to have Diet Coke. That's my caffeine to get me going. Go get that, sit down and read God's Word. My devotional life has been changed in the last few years when I bought a one-year reading Bible. I open it up and today's July the 12th. I go to July the 12th and I read for 15 minutes. I don't have to follow my reading plan. I have a separate Bible that I keep. It's just my devotional Bible. And I read God's Word for 15 minutes in peace and quiet. Folks, do not turn on the news the first thing in the morning. Do not open your phone and look at social media. If you want to ruin your day and ruin your life, open it up. Hear what the culture is telling you, all that is evil and all that is wrong, and there are horrible things going on. But if you want to be comforted, if you want to have God's perspective on things, the first thing you should put into your mind and into your life should be the Word of God. That should not be secondary to what the culture is telling us. The authority of Scripture, a mature believer understands. This is the guide to our life. This is the source of our life. This is the actual Word of God that has been revealed to us. And so when you have questions in life, well, I'm not hearing from God. I don't understand what God wants me to do. Read more Scripture because this is God's revelation of Himself to us. This is His gift to us. Mature believers understand that. And so you may be at a point in your life where you've just kind of neglected the Scripture. Maybe you have not put as much emphasis on the Word of God. Well, I'm just here to tell you this morning that if you want to have a life that is in the middle of God's will, you will understand the authority of Scripture and get back in it. Look at the beginning of verse 11 here. Does anybody know? I asked this last night, and there was actually somebody new. Anybody know what a goad is? The words of the wise are like a goad. Anybody know what that is? David, thank you. We got one. Good. Anybody know what a cattle prod is? Yeah. We know what a cattle prod is, right? That's the modern-day goad, right? So in the old days, the shepherd would have the rod and the staff to protect the flock from the outside predators, right? But then they had a shorter stick with a point on the end called a goad. And the point of that goad was to protect the sheep from whom? The sheep. Did you know that the sheep's worst enemies are themselves, right? I mean, sheep, honestly, are one of the dumbest animals known to man, right? Sheep would, you know, if this is the edge of the cliff, they would just walk over and just walk off the cliff. That's why the shepherd's there. And so when they begin to stray, the goad would come along, the shepherd would use it, and he would just prod them, poke them gently, enough to inflict enough pain to move them back into the center of the path and not go into danger. That's what God's Word does. When we're in the Scriptures and we allow the Word of God to be the authority in our life, we are all fallen, fallible men. But the Word of God corrects us and brings us back in. That's why Solomon calls it the goad, the words of the wise. Secondly, it's also the collected sayings are like nails that are firmly fixed. What he's talking about there, we don't understand this in our homes, but in the Jewish culture especially, they would have what they called a peg in the home. And there would be this peg they would build, and they would literally just take it and just drive this thing in, just over and over and over, till that peg was immovable. It wasn't going anywhere. It's not like those picture hangers you hang today, right? You ever had that moment in your life where you hear a crash and that nail has come out of the wall and a picture's fallen. This is not that kind of nail, folks. This is a peg that has been driven in so hard, it is immovable. And what the people would do is they would hang all of their valuables that they had on that peg. And if there was ever a fire, if there was ever danger, if there was ever an attack, and they had to flee quickly, they knew they had to do one thing. They had to run by, grab what they needed off that peg, and then run out the door. But the point he's making is that peg never moved. That peg never failed. They knew in time of danger, their belongings would be where? On that peg. It hadn't gone anywhere. That's what the Word of God is. The Word of God doesn't change today. It's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Right? And so if you want to base your life on something, I implore you, I beg you with all that is in me to base your life on the Word of God and not on anything else. Don't base it off what I say. Don't base it off what Pastor Mark says, what Pastor Bobby says. Base it off the Word of God itself. He says this, as I think it's very interesting. He says in verse 12, my son, beware of anything beyond these. Remember when I talked about not turning on the news first thing or social media? There's a lot of really just non-truth that goes on there. And don't base your life, don't base your decisions on that. Base it on the Word. He says this, I love this. Of many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. I've got a bet for you, right? So I bet you, and don't take this bet, I'll bet you a Diet Coke that in 2021 through 2050, there will be at least 1 million new books published each year. It's astonishing. And this is what Solomon is writing some 4,000 years ago. And he's talking about that same concept. And really, while the study, he's not saying that studying and intellectual knowledge is not valuable. He's not saying that there are books written by Christian authors that we should be reading. He's not saying that at all. But what he is saying is, if you're studying those more than you are God's Word, your priorities are out of line and you are not classified as a mature believer. And he's being very clear about that. And honestly, all those books that are being written are the same thing that Solomon has talked about in Ecclesiastes. They are an attempt to try and find fulfillment, contentment in life that just does not exist without God. Mature believers understand that. Lastly this morning, very quickly, mature believers trust and obey God. I love the hymn that Charles sang for us this morning. He ruined my conclusion by singing it, so I'm going to change that up because that was my plan to say those last words this morning at the end. I'll still do it. But the end of the matter, it all has been heard, beginning of verse 13. The end of the matter, all has been heard. What Solomon's saying is, look, this is it. This is all. We're done talking. I've preached 4 sermons in this book. I've taught. I'm an old king. Look, I'm here to tell you, this is what all of life boils down to. And then what does he say next? Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, all of your life boils down to one thing. Have you trusted God and obeyed his commandments? I don't care this morning what your occupation is or was. I don't care where you live. I don't care your ethnicity. I don't care your income level. I don't care your country of origin. I don't really even care your NFL team preference or your college team preference. Well, I care about college a little bit, but in the big scheme of things, I really don't. Those things don't matter. We joke about that, but it doesn't matter. The one thing that matters, and all of life boils down to this, have you trusted and obeyed God? That's it. That's what the author means when he says, vanity of vanity, all is vanity. All that we go through in life, our jobs, our houses, our cars, our work, all these things, it is vanity because all of life boils down to that one decision. Have you trusted and obeyed God? Interesting there, the word fear there. When we think of fear in our culture, at least in my mind, I think of that kind of that negative reaction, right? Where we have this emotional reaction and worrisome about something. That's not the fear, the biblical fear. Biblical fear means that we recognize who God is. is. We recognize his sovereignty. We recognize his holiness, his righteousness. And most importantly, we recognize that who we are and that we are not God. And when we recognize that, we begin to worship him. We worship the fact that he has saved us by grace through faith. We worship him for who he is. That's what fearing God is. And so in our terms, in our culture, I like the term trust better because I think we understand a little bit better. We have essentially, when we trust God, a spiritual believer has trusted God, has placed his faith in Jesus Christ. But then he hasn't stopped there, and she hasn't stopped there. She then has moved from just trusting to now obeying. There's a two-step process. And we understand the importance of that. I think it's very important to note the word order here. Solomon doesn't say that you keep his commandments and fear God. No, he says fear God and keep commandments. Because our keeping the commandments, our obedience, is a result of our trust. We can't keep his commandments until we trust him, right? The Pharisees are a wonderful example of this in Scripture. The Pharisees knew Scripture. They understood the Word. They memorized the Word. They could repeat the Word, but they did not follow nor obey the Word. And it's a two-step process. And lastly, just look at 14 with me real quick. As Solomon writes this book, he doesn't want to finish this. I think Ecclesiastes, personally, points to the gospel all throughout the book. If you go back and look at what he's talking about, he's referencing Genesis 1, 2, and 3 over and over and over. He's talking about the vanity of life without God. He's talking about that over and over and over. And look at verse 14. He says, look, for God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. And one last attempt and one last plea, he lays it down on the table, that one declaration, that one call for repentance. And what he's saying is, look, we all will stand before God one day. We will all stand before him. The only difference between those who have trusted in God and those who have not is that our sins, our evil things that have done in private and done in secret or done in public, our evil things are covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. By his blood we are made righteous. By his blood we are made clean. But we are just as guilty and we are just as dirty as those who have not placed their trust in him. And the only difference in that moment is that while our sins are covered by the blood, those who are not believers are not covered by the blood. And Jesus will say, depart from me, I know you not. And they will spend eternity in hell. And hell is that place where the presence of God is no more. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as bad as it may be right now in our culture, man, God is still here. And I can't fathom what it will be like when there is no God in that place called hell. So if you're watching online this morning, or if you're here and you've never made a decision to put your faith, to put your hope, to put your trust in Jesus Christ, as the author Solomon is begging you this morning, as I'm begging you this morning, some 4,000 years after he penned these words, consider the one major decision in your life. Have you put your hope, your faith, and your trust in Jesus Christ? You are not good enough to save yourself. Your good is not enough. So this morning, as we kind of ponder in our own lives, I just want you, as we enter here in a moment into this time of kind of reflection, I want us to think about where we started and where we are in our life, and more importantly, in our spiritual journey. We need to understand that spiritual maturity, that is a life focused on learning and following God's word. That is what Solomon's telling us. That is what leads to spiritual maturity in Christ. And as mature believers, we need to strive to study the Word and teach the Word. We need to understand the authority of Scripture. And when questions come and when we have doubts and we have fears and we have all these other things, we need to understand that the Word of God is the sole authority in our life. And we must not neglect that. And we must trust and obey. And I love the hymn that Charles sang this morning. It's so perfect for the message that Solomon's writing, right? That last phrase, trust and obey, For there's no other way, no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for just the opportunity to come and to gather and to study your word. Lord, I just thank you for the authority of your word, the comfort, the correction, the rebuke, the leading, the wisdom, the everything that it is in my life and in the lives of these believers. So I pray that those who have trusted in you this morning, Lord, I pray that we are challenged to obey you. And Lord, for those who do not have a personal saving relationship with you, for those who have not acknowledged their need for a Savior that are still trying to do it on their own, may they recognize this morning that they are not good enough. Father, none of us are. And the only way into a right relationship with you where our sins are forgiven and we are in your presence again is to admit our sins, believe that you are the Son of God, and commit our lives to follow you. So, Father, I just pray this morning in this time of reflection that you would open our eyes, open our hearts, and may we listen to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Very quickly, in this time of COVID, we're not going to have the traditional time of response where you come forward. But I do want you, just as we sing, as Charles leads us and April leads us in song this morning, I want you to think about if you've never made that decision to follow Jesus Christ, if you've never trusted him, would you consider doing that today? Life is vanity without God. There's no other way to say it. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, if you have trusted in him, my question is, are you still, like Paul describes, drinking the milk? Or are you chewing the meat? Have you progressed in your walk with the Lord to be that spiritual follower of Jesus Christ? Are you teaching and studying God's word? Do you understand the authority of Scripture? And are you doing whatever it takes in your life to trust and obey? As Charles and April lead us in song, let's stand this morning as we listen to the Holy Spirit.
Let's stand together.
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted. Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thine atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
You may be seated.
Hey, church family, we just have a few quick announcements for you. The first is that VBS... Hey, church family, we just have a few quick announcements for you. The first is that VBS is happening this year. I know we're uncertain, but we're super excited that July 26th through 29th, we're going to have VBS this year. It's going to be for those going into kindergarten through those that have finished fifth grade. Also, because of our size limitations, it's going to be a little bit different this year. So kindergarten, second, and fourth graders are going to be coming on our A days, which are going to be Sunday and Tuesday. And then first, third, and fifth graders will be coming on our B days, which will be Monday and Wednesday. And that's just going to help us with size limitations, and we're going to do a lot outside and different things. But however, we want to be understanding for all of our families. So if you've got kids that are in those age groups and you're like, man, I can't go A and B days, no. We want you all to come on one day, and we will put those kids in the right group. So we're looking forward to having that this year. We're going to ask you to go to mabc.church/VBS to go ahead and register, and we'll look forward to having a great time this summer for VBS.
Hey, church family, our second annual He-Man Student Ministry Golf Tournament is coming up soon. We need you to sign up today. Do you have what it takes to beat me and my team? I don't know. I'm not sure. You got to sign up to figure it out. Can you beat Bobby's team? Can you beat Bryce's team? Bryce's team won last year. He's a dang good golfer. So you better sign up. The money and proceeds go to missions and our student ministry. Sign up today, mabc.church/golf. Thank you.
Hey guys, want to let you know again about our upcoming free simulcast for the Promise Keepers. We're going to be hosting that on Friday, July the 31st at 5:30 p.m. and then Saturday morning at 8 o'clock on August the 1st. Come join us. It's going to be a great lineup of speakers. We're going to worship together. We're even going to have our famous Ironman crew serve us breakfast on Saturday. So sign up for this for us so we have a head count, please. If you just go to mabc.church/Ironman, all the details are there as well as registration link. We hope to see you there.
Church family, thank you for watching our announcements. We hope that you have a wonderful week. Please remember that our focus is to have a summer of connection where you go to our website because you have been praying twice a day, connecting with somebody in our church family twice a week, and even reaching out to your one twice in a month. I've been so encouraged over the last few weeks that people have been reaching out and having gospel conversations. So make sure that you go to www.mabc.church/2x2x2 and let us know about your time with the Lord in prayer, your reaching out to your church family, and then you're connecting with your one. Thank you. Have a wonderful week. See you next week.
Let's stand as we're dismissed today. He lives.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Have a great Sunday.